Thank you. Thank you very much. We're a little out of sorts this morning, a little out of order of what we normally do. At this time, normally after we sing a song like Cornerstone, we'll come gather around the table and we'll partake of our time of communion together. But because our topic this week in Core 52, and Joseph, if I could get you to go ahead and pull the PowerPoint up there for us. Our topic this week is communion. So I thought, well, let's look at the topic a little bit more closely, and then maybe it'll have a little bit deeper meaning for us when we get there. At least I'm hoping that it does. I think sometimes we, and when I say we, I mean me, sometimes I tend to rush through that part of our service, and I don't give it its proper attention. I don't pay enough attention to it and what God is truly trying to do and let us know through that. So we're going to take our time this morning. We're going to go through that, and we're going to look at communion this morning. And I'm going to ask a question to those of us who did not grow up in the church. Have you ever wondered why Christians eat a small piece of bread and drink a sip of wine or grape juice in some church services? Have you ever wondered that? Now, you're not alone. I think even as an adult, I've wondered, well, why do we do this? Why do we do this? For thousands of years, the church has continued a practice that we call here communion. We also call it the Lord's Supper. We call it the Lord's Table. It's called communion or a cup of blessing in 1 Corinthians. It's called breaking of the bread in Acts chapter 2. Eucharist would be one word that some of our fellow believers use. And generally, by the Latin church, the word mass was used. Ite missa est means go, it is discharged. It's part of the mass. The communion uses a couple of symbols for Jesus' body and his a symbol for his blood. And it sounds strange. Why do Christians talk about eating Jesus' body and drinking Jesus' blood? I mean, are we cannibals? Well, the first century church was accused of cannibalism, accused of strange and unordinary ways. They were accused of being the same as the pagan nations around them that would offer sacrifices and drink the blood of animals and drink the blood of things like that and eat that meat. But communion is celebrated in Christian churches around the world, and it's more than a mid-service snack. It's more than just something to grab a hold of, especially when we look at it, because, I mean, our crackers are really small and the juices are really small, so it's not really even a snack. So what is it? What is it? Why is it celebrated in so many different ways? We'll talk about this again Wednesday night on our Zoom class. I believe my cast class was this week, and we'll dive a little bit deeper into our Core 52 book and what we talk about today. But what is communion? What is communion? The dictionary says that it's the sharing or exchanging of intimate thoughts and feelings, especially when the exchange is on a mental or spiritual level. We're sharing intimacy, talking with one another. We're sharing thoughts and ideas and feelings towards one another. That's communion. That's one way to define it. Matthew chapter 26, Mark chapter 14, Luke chapter 22, and 1 Corinthians chapter 11 define it as part of a Christian worship service, which bread and wine are consecrated and shared. We pray over them and then share them with one another. The kind of bread, whether it's leavened or unleavened, is not specified. And before you lose your minds on that one, Christ, because our church and fellowship has used unleavened bread for hundreds of years. And that's the only bread that you're allowed to use, according to some people. But the reason Christ used unleavened bread was because it was the time of the Passover. And they were sharing their Passover meal. And they were sharing unleavened bread because it had to be made hastily, eaten hastily, because they were getting ready to flee Egypt. Don't put leaven in the bread and give it time to rise. Eat unleavened cakes. Gird up your loins. Be ready to go. He says that on that Passover table, to take this fruit of the vine, is what we call it, grape juice. Some congregations and some of our fellow brothers will tell you that wine is the only thing that can be served at the communion table because that's what Jesus drank. I'm not certain about all that. I know that having a problem with alcohol, I am certainly glad that we only drink grape juice. Welch's is just fine with me. But according to Easton's Bible Dictionary, when we talk about eating the body, and when we talk about drinking the blood, we're not talking about doing it with our mouth like a zombie or like a cannibal. No, we're talking about taking Christ into our soul. We're talking about our faith in Him allows us to partake in this meal. And we remember Jesus. We think about Him. It's from our hand into our soul and the power of the Holy Spirit working inside of us brings those things closer to us, brings Jesus closer to us. And this feeding on Christ doesn't just take place at the Lord's Supper alone. No, it's everything that we do. Every time we exercise our faith in Christ, we are taking Him into us. We are allowing Him to be a part of us. Now, the origin of the Lord's Supper was instituted by Christ Himself. It was installed by Jesus Christ. Da Vinci painted a wonderful painting here, Jesus in the middle, the apostles on either side. That's a lovely painting, nowhere close to what it actually looked like, I'm certain, because they were reclining and they were sitting in a circle. But in Matthew chapter 26, this is what he says. Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." And he uttered these words at the last meal. We find that in Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 28. The last meal that he shared with his disciples before his death, it was the Passover again, the time during which the Jews commemorated their escape and delivery from Egypt. It was an important meal, one to be shared with your closest members of your family. And yet here's Jesus sharing it with his disciples. Notice who's not there. His mother, his brothers, his sisters, those of his household. No, the people that were closest to Jesus, the people that he was communing with, the people that he was intimate with and sharing his thoughts and sharing his feelings with were these 12 men, the apostles. He instituted this supper. He took a variation of the Passover supper and made it about himself, not selfishly, not looking to be glorified on his own, but he took it and he said, all these things that we've done in the past, this bread and all these cups that we're going to drink here in the supper, all this pointed to me. All this pointed to me, the Son of God. Remember, we talked about incarnation a few weeks ago? God in flesh. He came because he loved us. Because of that love for us and because of who he is, we worship him. And as incredible as it sounds, God, the creator of all things, the giver of life, the sustainer of life, our Savior says, I want to share a meal with you. I want to commune with you. I want you to understand that when you do this, you are in the presence of me. You are in the presence of God. It's not to be taken lightly. It's not trite. It's not something rote. It's not a checkbox. Well, did we take communion today? Yes, we did. It's more important than that. As early as the second century, in Acts chapter 2, actually even, not the second century, but as early as Acts chapter 2, we see the Christians gathering together on a weekly basis to break the bread. In the second century, we see a fresco painting, wrong direction, called the Fractio Pani, the breaking of bread. That's Latin for breaking of bread. Y'all didn't know I was that smart, did you? Fractio Pani. And on this, it's an archway and some catacombs. There are people gathered around the table. And you can see on either side of them, you can see baskets of loaves on one side and baskets of fishes on the other. And people there in the middle breaking bread. And that's what that means. Fractio Pani, breaking bread. As early as the second century, they were drawing pictures of it. As early as 60 days, 50 days after Christ's death and resurrection, they were celebrating communion. In the fourth century, little history lesson here, Emperor Constantine the Great converted to Christianity, and he effectively ended the persecution of Christianity, the state persecution of Christianity. And this caused Christianity to become Vogue. Anybody know what Vogue means? We have a magazine called Vogue. In fashion, it's fashionable to be a Christian. The Roman Catholic Church took that and ran with it, grew in power, and they split from the Eastern Orthodox Church in 1054. Of an event that became known as the Great Schism. I'm not casting stones at the Catholic Church. Please don't misunderstand that. I'm not casting stones at anyone. Just telling you the history of where we are. The Catholic Church continued to grow through the Middle Ages. It was the most powerful political and spiritual entity in Europe. Even kings bowed down to the Pope. And the threat of excommunication and not being able to partake in the Eucharist, in the communion, was enough to cause monarchs to drop to their knees. Kings, the most powerful people on the earth, bowed down in order to be able to take communion. As one of the sacraments of the Roman Catholic Church, the Eucharist was administered by priests. However, the Protestant Reformation and the birth of Protestant ideology, communion began to change. Protestants fractured into dozens of denominations, various ways of taking communion developed until today. We have a multitude of traditions. I would dare say that there are as many traditions of communion as there are churches in the world. Each congregation has their own tradition. We, if I may reveal this, due to our post-COVID times, serve the loaf, the bread, in a little plastic cup, and we have a small plastic cup for the fruit of the vine. I'm going to hold this one because this one's now mine. I touched it. But it's more than just a small piece of cracker, a small piece of the loaf, a small drink from the fruit of the vine. What is the purpose? What is the purpose of communion? We had it up on our screen earlier. I think our screens have gone out, but there's this passage. Do this in remembrance of me. Paul writes about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 25. I believe it's found in the Gospel of John as well. Jesus really didn't give a lot of specifics about how to take communion. Instead, he gave an object lesson to his disciples. He said, you see how this bread and drink are necessary to bring you life, because in that context, he's talking about eternal life. You know, when we talk about eating and drinking, those things bring us nourishment so that we can live. He says, in the same way, when you eat and drink of this now, and thinking of me, I'm going to give you spiritual life. I'm going to feed you spiritually. I'm going to give you life. John will say that he came that we may have life and have it to an abundance, both in this realm of existence and the future when we get to go to heaven. When we take communion, what's the purpose of it? Is to remember the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. The bread and wine are tangible reminders, visible reminders of Christ's love. Rather than simply saying remember, Jesus gave us a reminder. Just as we depend on food and drink to live physically, we now depend on Jesus to live spiritually. And a communion of communion is a time of just that. It's communing. It's a chance to bring ourselves before the Lord, partake in the life He has given us through His death and resurrection. It's also a time to be in community. A community of fellow believers, both past and present. This is an ordinance that has stretched from the original apostles and original disciples up until today, the 21st century. Some 2,000 years we've been practicing this. We've been participating in this. We've been remembering this. And though they are not physically with us, we participate in a very real sense. We participate with those who originated it. Charles Watt used to sit in that rocker there. The second one back, the big one there. Charles is no longer with us in this physical realm. But I know that every time I partake of this, I remember Charlie. I remember all the great, wonderful things that he did. And as great and wonderful as Charlie was, he wasn't Jesus. When we commune, we get together with those that have come before us, those who have paved the way with their faith, who have laid their faith down as a road for us to travel. We get to think about the future. Who will I be able to commune with? And not just that, we get to commune with believers all over the world. Think about that for a second. We're not just gathered together in this room together this morning with some 30-odd people. We're gathered with others all over Austin. I mean, you can take a string in a 3-mile radius of this congregation, this building right here, and come up with at least a dozen different congregations that this morning may be partaking of communion. And then you draw that string around Austin, and you take it around Texas, and you take it around the United States, and then you take it to Croatia and Romania, where many of our loved ones, those that we know, those that we love, have already participated this morning because they're a few hours ahead of us. We are communing together. It's a community. Communion, community, same root word. It's a time for us to come together as God's people. It's a time to examine ourselves, to ensure that our relationship with Christ is authentic, that it's genuine. Joseph, there's a piece of paper right there underneath one of those monitors. It's a small piece of paper. A gentleman visited us a few weeks ago. He wrote on it. Can you read that for us? Read what that says. I will never lie before my God. A man who refused to take of the elements that morning because he didn't think that he was worthy. He didn't feel that he was worthy. He was not going to stand before God and proclaim to be a believer if he wasn't. Something was going on with him that morning, and he says, I'm not going to do this. I've examined myself. There's something not quite right. Another thing that we think about here is that how thankful we are. How thankful that we are each and every day that Jesus is here with us, that he died willingly on that cross. I don't know how it is that you get ready for our time of communion. Some stay ready. Some are concentrating on this relationship with Jesus and their relationship with God and their relationship with the Holy Spirit and their relationship with one another. They concentrate on that all week long. It's important to them. Some of us take and set a time aside on Saturday night to begin to understand, as we talked about last week, tomorrow morning is going to be a day filled with joy because I am going to worship. I am headed to a house of worship to be with my brothers and sisters, and I'm excited. I'm stoked to be there. And I need to make sure that if I have something against my brother, I need to go take care of that now. If I have something wrong in my life that's separating me from God, I need to take care of that now so that tomorrow when I go to worship, I can commune with my family. Some of us may not give it any thought at all. We just show up and we take the emblems and then we checked our box. I'm not pointing fingers because I got three headed right back at me. I'm not throwing rocks because I live in a glass house. Some things that help me, they may help you, they may not, but some things that help me. When I first think about communion, I think about a one-on-one time with my Savior. It's just me and Jesus sitting down at the table, talking. I want to thank Natalie Busk Thomas for this painting. She didn't paint it specifically for me. It's a part of her artwork. She has a book out called Jesus at, this one is called Jesus at the Table from a book, 50 Oil Paintings Inspired by My Christian Faith. Check it out. It's a woman who truly loves God. And in this picture, she captured, I think, what I see. We talk about communion. This is my body. This is my blood. It's hard to do when I've got 30, 40 other people around me. It's hard to do when I've got, I think about all the other vastness of the peoples that are come before me, those that are named. To start off with, I want to think about just me and my Lord. Just he and I sitting across from the table, where do you share some of your most intimate details of your life? You don't call people up on the phone, hey, Billy Joe Bob. Let me tell you what's happening to me. We do that often, but not it doesn't carry the same weight. And we certainly don't do it here in this setting. We make ourselves vulnerable from time to time, but rarely do we share what's really bothering us, what's really hurting us. We commune, we share our intimate thoughts, our feelings. When I'm sitting across the table from somebody that I love, somebody that I know, somebody that I have a relationship with, it's easy to talk about great thoughts. It's great to talk about feelings. So I sit down at the table and go one-on-one with my Savior. And once I get to that, and let me tell you, that all these thoughts come together and converge, and the human brain is one of the most incredible things that God has ever made, is that we can think about several different things at one time. And we can see several different pictures in our mind at one time. And another picture that's in my mind is that of a family reunion. Hit on this while I go. We come together with our family. Anybody ever had, I think Mark has spoken about family reunions in the past. Does anybody practice a family reunion in your family anymore? One or two people here and there. I remember as a kid, we rented the entire park in the city of Russellville. The entire park was ours for a day. They had police officers at the gate turning people away that were not a part of our family. And when I tell you, the Russellville Park was probably about 75 acres of campsites, basketball courts, swings, slides, just all kinds of places to grill and cook and play volleyball. It's incredible. And I, the last one I remember, I was probably 9, maybe 10. And my dad had just gotten remarried, and I had, it was me and my two younger brothers. And we were just about the age where we were starting to become athletic. And we thought we were it. And I got out there with some of my older cousins and some of my older uncles that I had never met. And they destroyed us in a game of softball. And then we sat down and had potato salad and ham and laughing and conversation. And we sang songs and just, we got together. We had been apart, and now we're back together. That's what it is for us this morning. We've been apart all week. Now we're back together. This is a family reunion. Another thing that I see in my mind is that of an orchestra and a choir. Now, if we were to all at one time sing our favorite song or give our favorite speech, just everybody piped up all at one time, that would sound like chaos, wouldn't it? Have you ever been in here for a fellowship meal? That's it. this table's talking about this, this table's talking about that, this table's talking here. You got songs breaking out, you got chatter. And if you just listen to it as noise, turn it off. But those are the altos and the sopranos and the tenors and the basses. Those are the string instruments coming in. Everybody converging. And while it may not sound like an orchestra or a choir singing to us, that laughter, that joy, that sharing is lifted up to God. I'm certain that it's a sweet sound on His ear. Paul chided the church at Corinth. We see there in 1 Corinthians chapters 11, 12, 13, 14. There was a lot of great variety in that church. I look around this room, there's a lot of variety. When you talk about socioeconomic place and stature, when you talk about educational level, when you talk about gender, when you talk about ethnicity, there's a lot of differences in here. We all have different experiences. When we come together, we celebrate those differences. This congregation, above any other congregation I've ever been a part of or seen, this congregation celebrates how different you are. Look, I'm standing up here preaching. If y'all don't think that's true, I've been here 10 years and y'all still allow me to come up here and preach. We celebrate differences here. We embrace them because we're family. Because we are the orchestra in that choir. Mike, I'm going to ask you, if you will, go let Andy and them know to come on down. We're almost to the end of our sermon time here. This time of communion is also a memorial service. Now, when we think about memorial services, especially in the church, it's just another word for a funeral. We've come together today to bury Jesus. But that's not why we've come together. That's not the memorial service we come. Because of our hope in Jesus Christ, it becomes a memorial service rather than a funeral, because we have the hope of what comes after. We have the hope of the resurrection. And if the person that you've come to memorialize has found their way into a relationship with Jesus Christ, they have that hope. You have that hope, and you remember all the great and wonderful things. I remember Charlie this morning. I'm sure that all of you remembered other people this morning. And we remember Jesus. It's a memorial service for Jesus. Oh, remember when he walked on the water. Remember when he did this. Remember when he pulled the fish, the coin out of the fish's mouth. Remember when he healed the Roman centurion's daughter. Remember when he raised that person from the dead. Remember when he did this. Remember when he rose from the grave. We remember. And we celebrate those memories. We celebrate in memory of what he has done for us also in the life to come. We celebrate the things that he's done for us in the past, but we celebrate and remember, we long for the things that he's going to do for us in the future. And when we have that thought process, we have that hope, when we look at that and place our hope in that, it empowers us to live our lives differently. It empowers us to overcome the trials and the temptations and the sorrows of this life. One of the main things that we try to teach our boys growing up is that life is not fair. Whoever said that life is going to be fair, life needs to be fair, was a liar. The truth could not be found in them. Life is not fair. Because your definition of fair and my definition of fair are going to be two different things. God rules by justice, mercy, and grace. He decides what is right and what is wrong, and who to punish, and who to save. We come together to remember that justice and vengeance are not ours to mete out. Ours to lift up and give to God and allow him his place. And then the last thing that we think about, or at least I think about, and again, I'm telling you, all these thoughts run together. This is a banquet. This particular banquet is for the Nobel Peace Prize. This is how they lay it out for the Nobel Peace Prize. Man, look at all those nice crisp plates and the wine goblets and all the candles and the flower arrangements. Everything that's going on, how nice and pristine and symmetrical and lined up everything is. You ever eat at my house? It's not going to look like that. If I invite you to a banquet at my house, don't come looking for that. We might have a lawn chair in one corner. We might have a beanbag in another. There might be some spots on the table left open for you to pull up a chair or to at least squat and eat off. That's not the banquet at our house. We're coming together to share a meal. In the first century church, that's what they did. They came together to share a meal. And during that meal, they would set a time to remember the things that Jesus Christ had done, to remember the things that God had done. The late great Scottish preacher Ian Pitt Watson told the story of a king who was displeased. He was displeased because there wasn't much joy in his kingdom. People were no longer smiling. They were so busy doing the work of survival that there wasn't much joy. So he called for a great banquet. He got the largest place in the capital city, invited many, and as they came into the banquet room that was sumptuously prepared, he had his servants tie the guest's left arm behind their back and put their right arm in a cast. It was bound. Can't move your left arm. Right arm is extended all the way out. Then you made your way to the table where your name card was and you sat down. And the king says, "You may begin." At that point, the cast went, and they're knocking the goblets over. They're knocking the food over. They're knocking everything. Every now and then, the guy might get a fork and get but there's a long way between here and there. And finally, one young gentleman said, "Hi. My name's so-and-so," as he looked directly across the table. "What's your name?" After the response, he said, "May I feed you?" "Yes, you may. May I feed you?" And so they began to feed one another. What was impossible to do on their own, they did for one another. Because that's what this meal does. It brings us together so that we may be united as one. Our congregation a few months ago decided to leave this table here so that we could come around it. I know that some of you have immune positions that keep you from being up here all the time. I'm not trying to downplay that. It's a scary thing in the world we live in today. Can be. We chose to make this, not this table, not this tablecloth, not the elements, not the flowers, which are beautiful again, many. Thank you. Ceremony central to what we do. 2,000 years we've been celebrating Jesus Christ. We've been communing with Jesus Christ. We've been communing with our brothers and sisters around the world. We come to this great banquet, and Jesus says, "One day I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I'll come back and I'll bring you home. And there you'll get together around the throne in the great banquet hall of God. And you'll get to dine with the angels, and you get to dine with those that have gone to sleep before you. More important, most important, you'll get to dine with me." Communion is so much more than just a cracker and a small cup of juice. It's so much more than anything I've been able to share with you this morning. We could preach from now till next Sunday about this particular topic and never exhaust it all. But our time this morning for this particular topic has come to an end, at least for what I have prepared here. But it is not at an end for us, because we are about to partake of communion together. So I'm going to ask you if you will close your eyes and pray with me. God, help us to imagine and to picture all these wonderful things. Our one-on-one time with Christ, our Savior. our family reunion, our orchestra and symphony. Our memorial service and our banquet, and so much more, Father. Search our hearts. May we empty our hearts before you. May we empty ourselves of those things that hinder us from having a deeper and more meaningful relationship with you. May we look around this room. May we be impressed by your sons and your daughters. May we find comfort and peace and joy and strength in the numbers that are gathered here this morning. And may we give you all the glory, remembering that without Jesus Christ, we are hopelessly lost. And with him, we are forever blessed. It's in his most precious name that we pray as we think about this bread, which was his body, and we think about this cup, which was his blood, shed for many, a ransom for many, a new covenant for those who choose to believe. May we humble ourselves and come before you this morning. May we commune with you this morning. May we please you, God. So, Jesus, our loving Savior, and by the power of the Holy Spirit that we pray, amen. For those who are believers in Jesus Christ, we invite you to the table at this time. Let's pray. Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Hebrews 13, verses 20 and 21. And at that, the children of God said, amen. May God's peace go with you this week. It has been an honor to serve you this morning. Shalom.